Hello, I'm Simon Whistler. You're watching the Today I Found Out YouTube channel, and in the video today, we're looking at whether trees poop and pee. A wise man once said, "Everybody poops." Well, that should probably be changed to "Everything poops," because all living things excrete waste. This brings us to a brilliant question posed by a subscriber to this channel called George, whose head we'd love to crack open and see what's going on inside because, well, George, he asks, do trees poop? As it so happens, yes they do, although there's a bit of a semantic argument to be had over what one might consider to be tree poop. And, well, there's a sentence that I never thought I'd ever say. To begin with, all living things excrete things that they no longer need, which otherwise might be harmful to them if allowed to build up in said being's system. Yep, everything from the lowliest single organisms to blue whales do this. In fact, a microbe known as Paramecium caudatum has been observed passing solid, liquid, and gaseous waste, meaning it technically poops, pees, and farts. This is all despite it consisting of just one single cell. So, well, what exactly do trees excrete? Now, although trees produce very little in terms of pure waste due to tremendously efficient metabolic systems that convert almost everything the plants take in to something that they can make use of, and a generally good nutrient acquisition system that ensures many things that would otherwise be bad for the plants aren't taken in at all, nothing is perfect, and trees will invariably need to excrete a number of things in order to remain healthy. The most well-known of these things is, of course, oxygen. Now, oxygen, which the tree, like any aerobic life form, does need, but invariably has an excess amount of as a natural byproduct of photosynthesis, is mostly expired, along with other gaseous waste, through small pores in the leaves of a tree, known as stomata. Trees also excrete water vapor containing various other waste products during this process. While this is an excretion, you may not consider this akin to pooping and peeing. Perhaps it's more like breathing. After all, humans expel carbon dioxide, water vapor, and certain other substances while breathing. So now you might be wondering, well, what's something that the tree does that is more like pooing and peeing? Well, in regards to the latter, some, but not all, plants occasionally expel water and other waste via a process known as guttation. In a nutshell, guttation occurs when excess water is taken into the roots, resulting in an upward pressure within the tree that must be gotten rid of. This generally occurs at night when the stomata are closed, robbing the tree of one way that it may get rid of such excess water. The result of this root pressure is a sticky sap consisting of sugar water and various other substances, including waste compounds, being pushed out of water stomata or hydrothodes in the leaves. So now, what about trees pooping? Plant cells contain large vacuoles that are variously used to store essential nutrients or waste that the plant no longer has use for. As regards to the latter waste, plants store it in parts of their anatomy that, while also potentially serving other purposes throughout those parts' life cycle, they are nonetheless destined to fall off or die. These can be leaves, petals, or even fruit. The waste, which in turn sometimes also serves a useful purpose but nonetheless must be gotten rid of lest it build up and ultimately harm the tree, including things like heavy metals, tannins, oxalates, and anthocyanins, will naturally be lost come wintertime for many trees, or just at random times throughout the year for evergreens. As famed biologist Brian J. Ford notes, the leaf not only is the plant's photosynthetic center, but also is the organ which, at the end of its anabolic program, is stripped of vital constituents and systematically charged with metabolic wastes. As a noteworthy example of this, mangroves are able to thrive in seawater despite too much salt being harmful for the plant. These plants don't actually need large amounts of salt to survive. In fact, many mangroves will grow just fine in fresh water. They achieve this by the fact that their roots have developed to take out as much as 90% of the salt from the water they take in, which is pretty remarkable considering such strong osmotic pressure would normally result in water being drawn out of the roots rather than being absorbed. Any salt that the plant does imbibe is then ultimately excreted through a combination of various processes. The most significant of these is the plant concentrating the salt in older leaves and bark, which will periodically be shed. So, given that many plants, such as trees, use their leaves and other eventual droppings as a way to get rid of waste, we'd like to explicitly point out here that when you're eating many types of fruit or drinking that delicious cup of tea, you're kind of eating and drinking bits of plant poop. Beyond things shed, many trees also store waste in their innermost tissues, for instance heartwood, which is sometimes considered to be dead upon formation, though some argue otherwise as it's still able to react chemically to certain things, such as various organisms that may cause decay in the tree if introduced. Nonetheless, this wood no longer plays an active role in the growth and metabolism of the tree, making it a safe place to concentrate waste materials that the tree cannot get rid of in other ways, or simply can't get rid of fast enough. In addition, trees may also expel waste through their roots, as has been observed via introducing an otherwise toxic substance to a portion of a tree's roots. For example, in one such study doing just this, it was later found that the toxic substance taken up by certain roots had later been, in turn, excreted by the rest of the roots. It should also be noted that, as previously alluded to, many plants and trees excrete things in a variety of ways that also very much have a purpose beyond letting something build up within their system. For many of these things, some consider them to be poop while others don't, as they may largely be made up of metabolic waste or other substances that could be toxic to the tree if not regularly excreted. For instance, some plants and trees are known to intentionally leach harmful waste products into the surrounding soil or from their leaves or bark as a defense mechanism. This can take the form of compounds that kill, trap, or deter pests from eating the plant, like latex, which among other things does include chemicals that are toxic to the plant itself. Some plants, such as the Scots pine, even produce waste products with antibacterial properties, helping to protect them from disease. So, in the end, while to some extent whether trees poop and pee or not, and which mechanisms constitute doing this, is an argument in semantics, they do unequivocally expel metabolic waste and other harmful substances in a variety of interesting ways. But which ones are most analogous to pooping, peeing, farting, or burping? Well, we're going to leave that for a discussion in the comments below. And now for some bonus facts. So at this point, you might be wondering whether carnivorous plants that actually eat living things pee and poop more like animals. After all, unlike most plants, these also take in the bodies of insects and the like. The question is, do these plants then have to poop these bodies out? While the mechanisms vary, generally speaking, what happens here is that after all the nutrients are extracted from the living thing, the plant will simply open back up and allow the remaining matter to be washed away in the rain or potentially be blown away by the wind. It's not a perfect system, however, and waste may still be potentially left in the plant, which can cause an issue if it's allowed to accumulate. So, how is this dealt with? Well, often the plant will simply get rid of the trap mechanism containing the waste itself. For example, consider the Venus flytrap. After a certain number of closures, around 10 to 12, or if a successful capture, 3 to 5 meals or so, a given trap will no longer respond to external stimuli and instead will simply perform its function in photosynthesis before ultimately being expelled from the plant. And now for another bonus fact. The fact that trees excrete otherwise toxic heavy metals as a waste product in their leaves has very recently been suggested as a way to find rich gold deposits deep underground and estimate their concentration, specifically using certain species of eucalyptus trees, which can have amazingly deep taproots. These can extend over 40 meters, that's about 130 feet, deep into the ground. In a study published in October of 2013 called Natural Gold Particles in Eucalyptus Leaves and Their Relevance to Exploration for Buried Gold Deposits, the researchers found that eucalyptus trees growing at the Freddo Gold Prospect in Western Australia were indeed transporting gold from far underground to the surface via taking it up from its deepest roots, then ultimately transporting much of the toxic gold to the leaves at upwards of 80 parts per billion accumulating in the leaves versus 44 parts per billion in the twigs, 4 parts per billion in the bark, and only 0.1 to 0.7 parts per billion in the trunk. Even though most eucalyptus trees are evergreens, ultimately, the leaves are shed, removing the toxic substance from the tree, though also resulting in it accumulating more in the topsoil. And now for another bonus fact. Speaking of eating tree poop, we also have the interesting case of figs, and you potentially eating wasp eggs or larvae and bits of wasp bodies along with the tree poop. You see, certain types of fig trees have a symbiotic relationship with wasps. The wasps lay their eggs inside immature figs, and in return, they pollinate it. Fig trees are able to tell when a wasp doesn't hold up its end of the bargain, and will often drop an immature fruit containing eggs if the wasp who laid them didn't pollinate it. What makes all of this even more interesting is that in some species, the wasp must actively pollinate the fig tree, rather than just it being a byproduct of the wasp being covered in pollen or the like, or passively pollinating the tree some other way. So if an active pollinator wasp tries to cheat the system to save itself a bit of effort, the fig tree is able to tell that, and rather than continue to waste resources on such an unpollinated fruit, it may sacrifice it. The downside for the the wasp, of course, is that their offspring won't survive, and it also increases the likelihood that cheetah wasps will be bred out. Unsurprisingly from this, it's been discovered that in fig species where non-pollination is most heavily sanctioned by the tree, active pollinator wasps that will attempt to cheat the system in this way are much more rare. Interestingly, there do exist other species of non-pollinating wasps which are happy to swoop into a pollinated fruit and lay their eggs inside as well, piggybacking on the pollinator wasp's efforts. And if at this point you're worried about accidentally eating a wasp body or body parts when eating a fig, this shouldn't typically be the case with commercially grown figs, which usually use a species that does not require pollination. However, with figs that do require pollination to grow mature fruit, it is likely that in eating such a fruit, you're getting bits of wing and antenna, as the female often loses these as she bores inside to lay her eggs. On top of that, once hatched, many species of male are not capable of flight and instead simply mate with the female, bore their way out, providing a path for the young female to exit, and then die, occasionally even dying inside the fig if they fail to make an exit. So I really hope you enjoyed that video. If you did, please do click that like button below, and don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already for brand new videos just like this every day of the week. Also, I'd like to take this moment to thank our patrons on Patreon. If you're interested in supporting us with a small monthly contribution, please do consider heading over to patreon.com/todayIFoundOut. We've got loads of cool perks lined up for anyone who does support us, so please do go check that out. And as always, thank you for watching.